Hey there, I'm Matt Schell and this is Thousand Ant. And in this devlog for my untitled cute space game, we are going to take a look at some of the systems code that I've been writing and some of the decisions that I've been making about the kind of fundamental game architecture. Let's check it out. First of all, thank you to all the folks who watched and commented on the first episode of the devlog. In this one, I am going to talk a lot about the code that's going into the game. I have had to write a bunch of pretty fundamental systems. The game is a kind of Animal Crossing-like. It features a lot of items and resources that kind of get turned into other items and refined and has a kind of a crafting system. In a way, it's kind of a big database of items. And so I had to think about what was the best way to structure that. I'm using a scriptable object-based architecture, and I've been having a lot of interesting discussions around that with some of my other developer friends, getting some feedback on some of the drawbacks of that architecture. I've published some other videos on the Thousand Ant channel about it, and I'm getting some great feedback from the comments as well. One detail about that kind of architecture that I think is worth pointing out is that scriptable objects are a really nice solution for design time, creating data and structuring data in the editor and being able to create references between things in the editor and being able to kind of work with your data in a visual and convenient way. What I wouldn't, and I'm not in my game, use scriptable objects for is data that's heavily mutable, that's constantly changing at runtime, for example, and that needs to be saved and loaded, for example. I want players to be able to start a refining job of turning some copper ore into some refined copper, quit the game, and come back, and the state has changed, that refinery job has finished, there's an output waiting for them to collect and to put into their inventory, right? And so I need to be able to save data about what's in the inventory, the state of that job, everything. The way that I'm approaching that is that I have this kind of separation of the copper ore type, which holds the icon, the name, maybe some other kind of data fields about that type of resource is a scriptable object, but then I have a plain non-mono behavior serializable C# class, which just has a bunch of public fields that I am using to store data. And importantly, because I add that system.serializable attribute, I can view it in the inspector and edit it and interact with it in the inspector. So I have this type of asset, right? Let's say copper ore, but I need to be able to create instances of copper ore that are actually in the game, let's say a stack of copper ore that's currently in the refinery, right? 5 copper ore that are being refined into refined copper. I'm saving everything in my game to JSON, and so I can't write into JSON, for example, a scriptable object that's been dragged into a field in another scriptable object. Those kind of references cannot be saved. We do get to some situations where I do want to reference back to an asset. Let's say I have a stack of copper ore. Well, I want to be able to reference the copper ore type, right? The scriptable object. And so what I've done is I've built a system based on global unique identifiers or GUIDs, right? A GUID, if you're not familiar with it, is a system that allows you to generate a unique long value. What's kind of interesting about GUIDs is the way they work is that the value is just has enough characters in it that it's like 90 million to one, that it's chance that it's unique, right? It's just kind of, they have such a big possibility space that it's very unlikely that you get two of the same IDs, right? But it's not actually prevented or checked against, which is kind of interesting. But basically using GUIDs, I can say, okay, I have a string GUID that is assigned to the scriptable object. This is the ID for this scriptable object. I save that ID string into my serializable data. And then at runtime, when the game runs, I use a dictionary of strings and my type, you know, copper ore type scriptable objects. And I pass in the string to look up which scriptable object I wanna use. This is working pretty well. There's some drawbacks to it, like right now in the inspector, I just have these kind of unreadable GUID strings instead of proper names. And there's definitely some stuff I can do to refine this implementation and make it better. But what I can do is fundamentally, I can work with my scriptable objects at edit time, and then I can serialize this data into a simple JSON class that I can just easily save and load from disk. I think at the moment it's working pretty well. And this is maybe a little kind of muddying the waters or confusing it. For convenience in the editor, I actually put all of that into a scriptable object so that I can kind of interact with it or have multiple copies or whatever. But fundamentally what I'm doing with that data is it's all serializable data that's just getting written to JSON on the drive and reread from JSON back into that object. And I think you can tell, right, I'm still getting my head around this as a paradigm. I'm still thinking about where the dividing lines and how I really want to structure things. And that's kind of the process that I'm engaged in now. And that's kind of why I've been making videos about it and thinking about it, because I'm trying to get something that is going to be robust and scalable and not just fall over. And at this moment, I'm pretty happy with that. I also set up the time system using the date time class, which is part of C Sharp. It's been kind of interesting digging into that stuff. I actually think that the code that I have at this point is not fully working. And it's funny, I showed it in another video and I had like, afterwards I was watching the video and I have a bunch of comments like, this might be bad. We're truncating this double to an int and that might cause problems. And you know, and I think there were like some mistakes in it and it was in the video and that's kind of funny. But I got that basically working where you reload the game, in this case, restart the game in the editor. It checks when was the last time you saved, what time is it now, and then rolls the simulation forward an appropriate amount. One of the decisions I'm a little bit wrestling with right now is I have been hooking up UI to this system. Something I was realizing in hooking up the UI and hooking up the references between the different systems was I'm passing these objects. I have this, it's called Astro Item Instance, which is a class that is basically one of these serializable C# classes. And then I also created a class that is a refinery job, right? That stores, this is the type of instance that we're working on. This is the output that we're gonna generate. This is the tick, how far along into the process are we? And I need to be able to save and load that from disk. And what I'm thinking about is actually just trying to make like a universal object, right? So that probably Astro Item Instance would actually get the properties of a job into it. And half the time or more than half the time, those would be redundant and unused. But that would make it easier for me to then just have one type of object that I'm just passing through to every function in the game and make it easier from a quality of life standpoint for programming. I don't think it's gonna be a performance problem. Famous last words, right? But from where I can see, I don't think this game is actually gonna struggle with performance a lot. And I'm more focused on, it's gonna be a kind of a content-based game, right? I'm gonna need to add a lot of items and a lot of stuff. And so I wanna make that easy and be able to make, you know, a lot of systems that can interact with those items in a clean and scalable way. And so I'm contemplating this decision of, should I just try to make a universal Astro Item class that contains, you know, all the fields of refinery job and any other process that that item might go through. The other really kind of anarchic, chaotic thing I was thinking about doing is because I do have this concept of items being contained within one another, or an item is in the cargo hold, or it's in the player's inventory, or it's in kind of different, or it's in the refinery, right? And one of the things that I was thinking about doing was just making like an ID on an item. This is contained within this other item, right? So you could kind of nest items recursively, and probably if you weren't careful, nest items back inside themselves, right? Obviously you'd need to defend against that and check against that, but I'm not sure. It would be really nice to be able to just check, is this in the refinery? Is this in one of the drones in space? Is it in the cargo bay? Is this resource deposit just still out in an asteroid, right? And that way, then it really just becomes this kind of database of everything in the world is just kind of in the same database, and we can just find out, query against, what's in this asteroid, right? Could be any number of things, including things nested in other things. This is kind of where if I had been a database programmer, it would have really helped me, right? But it's kind of fun to think about and learn about and think about approaches. So please actually drop me a comment down below if you have any input into this as a problem, or you face similar situations, kind of games with lots of items that need to be tracked with their state and that might have unique states and need to be saved and loaded and so on. If any of these are problems that you've faced and solved or run into a dead end on, if I'm like about to drive myself into an iceberg, please let me know. I've been talking to some friends and kind of like, what do you think about, is this, am I crazy doing it this way? And getting some good feedback, but I've been having some really interesting comments from folks on YouTube and in the Thousand Ant Discord. If you haven't joined us over there, do come. We're talking a lot about development and the business of games and indie games in general and stuff. It's been really, really fun so far. Drop a like on the video if you enjoyed it. It helps other people to discover the content via the YouTube algorithm, which we appreciate very much. And if you're not already subscribed, please do consider doing so. And yeah, I've just really been enjoying this process. I've been enjoying the conversation that we've been having around all these topics. And so I just want to thank you very much for being a part of it. And I will see you next time. Bye.